The victors of the 74th Hunger Games, Katniss Everdeen and Peter Mallock.
The Hunger Games Catching Fire is a continuation of the first Hunger Games in a series of books. It basically follows the character of Katniss, who in the first movie was thrust into this arena, and what happens to her after that. As soon as it came out online that Frances had gotten the job, people started texting me right away because they know of our relationship together. And it was pretty exciting.
Sound's always important to me in the making of any movie, and I've worked with this sound team a bunch for, you know, all of my movies, in fact. It's been really good because as the movies have gone on, started to work together earlier and earlier to start building the kind of world of sound for the movies. And we started to do a thing on I Am Legend where Jeremy would come in very early on in the process with his sound equipment and start building the world of the sound very early on in the editing process. So it's not doing the standard thing where you sort of wait until the end and then kind of start over sound-wise.
We'll have an initial spotting session where we'll all get together with Alan, the picture editor, and ourselves, and we'll talk about the reel, we'll talk about the movie. How far do you want to go in this direction? Do you want it to be sci-fi? Do you want it to be more organic? All those kind of things. And then he just kind of sets me loose. And since I'm just down the hall, he comes in 2-3 times a day and says, what do you got? And no matter in what condition I'm at or what state it's at, I just show it. That in itself is a pretty unique thing because you tend to have a more formal setting for these kind of things. It's more of a playback, a presentation. Whereas he's looking at, you know, the work in progress of where it is to where it can go, and it's always kind of exciting for him to see the kind of minute details, because he's definitely listening to it. Just, I take out all the music and all the dialogue at that point, and he's just hearing what I'm adding to it.
Skip and Jeremy and I all have a great relationship in terms of sort of developing what the soundscape is going to be. And just as the districts have their own sort of visual cues, they would have their own kind of a sound cue, and the Capitol has a very distinct look and feel. Visually, it has its own sound, sort of sonic feel.
Because this is a sequel, we kind of had a foundation of where we needed to start. And it was just a matter of kind of pushing that out a little bit, partly because of the story and the evolution of the character, we could kind of intensify things. We could go a little bit further than the first movie went. Part of our approach with the arena was to make it really dense, really busy, really exotic, to kind of add a claustrophobia, that when you're with these characters, you're always surrounded, and it's not just some meadow out in the woods. So you kind of got a little bit of liberty to just kind of make it cool and make it really exotic and make it different. Part of what we did is try to make each sequence of flowing from one scene into the other be similar, yet uniquely different to its own location. There was a lot of jungle stuff that I had used library for. However, I supplemented it by, I went out to Maui and recorded a lot of the jungle and some of the ocean out there, just because I knew Maui and I knew certain places I could get into and hike into, and that was a lot of fun. I went up and recorded a bunch of baboons for the monkey fight sequence, and that was a pretty unique opportunity because I was with 9 baboons, and rarely do you get that many variety of animals that you can record simultaneously. In a lot of those places, because I'm hiking in carrying a certain amount of gear, at the very basic point, I'll do 2 stereo pairs. And a lot of times what I'll do is I'll kind of point them away from each other and have the mics 70 feet apart from each other, and that kind of creates a unique quad type layout. But I'm also using 2 different types of microphones so that even the same location sounds completely different from each other. Personally, I'm not a fan of having hard cuts unless it's specifically used for an effect or a reason. The jungle is a perfect example of backgrounds sweeping in, you know, 6 seconds before we go into the next scene, or sometimes the opposite of whatever ambience that you're in, that's leaving as you go into the next one. So it's kind of there's always a certain amount of cross between scenes. There's a couple of shots in the movie where you're going from somewhere in the Capitol to the jungle, and you start to hear bugs and, you know, the jungle ambience over that, but that kind of really guides you into the next scene. Anytime that we're in the jungle, there's always a constant presence of canopy leaf movement over our heads the entire time that we're there. It's always there. It's not something that you notice, but it's always there, it's always present, and it's this oppressive, claustrophobic feeling the entire time.
The thing that really interested me about Atmos was just that I'm always interested in making the experience as immersive as possible. And what I really liked about it was, you know, we didn't want to get too sort of tricky with it, with sending people sort of looking around them all the time. But the idea of being able to sort of feel like you're surrounded, you know, that when you're in a jungle, you've got this kind of sound that sort of surrounds you from every dimension, right? That it's like above you and off to the sides and down below and all of this. And so to be able to kind of create that feeling for the audience, the feeling that they're in the jungle with Katniss and Peeta, is a pretty cool thing. A lot of our jungle sequences, you know, just sound the way they do because of Atmos. And I think that there's certain sequences, like there's a monkey attack sequence. There's a fog sequence. There's a sequence that's really, truly based on sound. That's the Jabberjay sequence. And, you know, they're completely surrounded by these birds and completely immersed in them. And so now we can give the audience the same feeling. And it makes it a very intense and sort of psychologically heartbreaking sequence. And part of that is because of Atmos.
It's a new, exciting format because it really is what high def picture is to standard def. This is that. The amount of resolution that you get panning through speakers is pretty awe-inspiring. I would say that it was a lot of fun, knowing that everything that we're doing is going to be heard and, you know, is really going to be picked apart to a certain degree. Granted, the particular team that we have, it's been from music to picture editorial, has been a solid group, you know, for a number of movies. So it's been exciting, quite honestly.